The Two Deliverances. The two atonements of Leviticus 16, the enrapturing and rapture of the church. The marriage of the Lamb, when? Copyright 2006, 2010, Doug Mitchell. The Branch, P.O. Box 1004, Kingsland, Texas 78639. http://www.the-branch.org. Email info@the-branch.org. Study aim. To show that, 1. There are actually two times of deliverance for the saints. The first deliverance is at the end of the time of Jacob's trouble, when the first fruits are delivered by the voice of God from a little time of trouble, and then enraptured while they are yet on earth. The second deliverance is at Christ's second coming in the clouds of heaven, when every eye shall see him, which comes after the first fruits have finished their final conflict and have brought in the second fruits from the greater time of trouble, when all the saints, the living and the resurrected, will be raptured to heaven. 2. The two deliverances are typified in the ceremonies of the Day of Atonement as delineated in Leviticus 16. 3. The call for God's people to come out of Babylon, Revelation 18:4, is not the final work for the church, for God will still have other of his children who will not be among those who will be in Babylon at the time the call goes forth to call his people out of her. That is, Babylon symbolizes the fallen churches, not the whole of the world, even though, quote, all nations have drunk of the wine of the wrath of her fornication, and the kings of the earth have committed fornication with her, and the merchants of the earth are waxed rich through the abundance of her delicacies, end quote. Revelation chapter 18, verse 3. And even though she will eventually ride the scarlet-colored beast for a while, Revelation chapter 17, verse 3. Though the woman, Babylon, rides the scarlet-colored beast, the New World Order, she does not represent the same things that that beast does. Prior to her riding on the beast, she was seen sitting upon many waters, peoples and multitudes and nations and tongues, Revelation chapter 17, verse 15. As she was seen only to be upon many waters, people, and not all of them, there must be others who have not come under her direct influence. These also must hear mercy's last call. It is due to her influence over the, quote, many waters, end quote, peoples, that she is able to mount the scarlet-colored beast. They will put her there. But she is not them. Moreover, it is written, quote, the seven heads are seven mountains on which the woman sitteth, end quote. Revelation chapter 17, verse 9. Mountains, and thus heads, are symbols of churches, Isaiah chapter 2, verses 2 through 4, and Micah chapter 4, verses 1 and 2, and not of the whole world. When Babylon is made naked and is destroyed by the ten horns of the scarlet-colored beast, Revelation 17:16, she is no more, Revelation chapter 18, verses 21 through 24. But that beast, i.e., those whom it represents, remains until it is destroyed by he who comes riding upon the white horse, Revelation chapter 19, verses 11, 19, and 20. That is, the rider on the white horse does not engage in war with Babylon, the woman, but rather with, quote, the scarlet-colored beast and the kings of the earth and their armies, end quote. Revelation chapter 19, verse 19. Thus, the call out of Babylon and her fall are one thing, and the gathering of the great harvest from the rest of the world and its subsequent fall is another. The call for God's people to come out of Babylon coming first. 4. Those who come out of Babylon will join the first fruits of the remnant church in giving the final call to the great multitude of God's children who are elsewhere than in Babylon. Currently, there are approximately 2.1 billion professed Christians in the world of over 6.75 billion people. If only about 1/10 of those in Babylon, the fallen churches, respond to the call to, quote, come out of her, my people, end quote, Revelation chapter 18, verse 4, that would amount to 200 million Christians to evangelize the numerically greater non-Christian world, approximately 1 Christian to 24 non-Christians. Those who don't understand the significance between the first and second deliverance can't understand the great and glorious work that is to be accomplished in this sin-cursed earth before Christ returns in the clouds of heaven. 5. At the time the first fruits are delivered, they will be enraptured, having been brought into the full bond of the covenant that takes place at the marriage of the Lamb, while Christ is still in the sanctuary. This meaning that they will be glorified on earth, Revelation 14, verses 1 and 4, while still in their mortal state, delivered from every outward foe and empowered to deliver the second fruits. 6. The first fruits, Revelation 14, verse 4, are 144,000 in number. But they are not all of the first fruits, for those who come out of Babylon, whom God calls my people, are also a part of the first fruits, and together with the 144,000, they will bring in the second fruits from all nations, a, quote, great multitude which no man can number, end quote. Revelation chapter 7, verse 9. These two parts of the first fruits are typified by the two wave loaves presented before the Lord on the day of Pentecost, and by the two numbered companies that received the outpouring of the Holy Ghost on the day of Pentecost, the 120 and the 3,000, Acts chapter 1, verse 15, and chapter 2, verse 41. 7. Because the church has failed to understand and give proper significance to the two distinct deliverances of first and second fruits, which are typified in the events of the Day of Atonement as portrayed in Leviticus 16, they have generally abandoned the teaching that the 144,000 are a literal number, instead spiritualizing away the statements in the spirit of prophecy to that effect. It wasn't too many decades ago when the majority of the Adventist leadership taught that there would be only 144,000 saints alive when Christ returns, and that the rest of the church would be laid to rest before or during the final conflict with the powers of evil. They based that teaching on an incomplete knowledge of the Bible and testimonies of the spirit of prophecy, and on private interpretations. But, as the church grew to many times that number, many have come to gradually abandon their faith in the statements made concerning the 144,000 being a literal number, instead teaching that the number is only symbolical. Key texts, quote, alas, for that day is great, so that none is like it. It is even the time of Jacob's trouble, but he shall be saved out of it. For it shall come to pass in that day, saith the Lord of hosts, that I will break his yoke from off thy neck, and will burst thy bonds, and strangers shall no more serve themselves of him, end quote. Jeremiah chapter 30, verses 7 and 8. Quote, and in the days of these kings shall the God of heaven set up a kingdom which shall never be destroyed, and the kingdom shall not be left to other people, but it shall break in pieces and consume all these kingdoms, and it shall stand forever. End quote. Daniel chapter 2, verse 44. Note that it says in, not after, the days of these kings. Memory gems. Quote, although we are now passing through the night of tribulation, We need not be discouraged by the darkness that surrounds us. The Lord desires us to exercise faith, with spiritual vision looking beyond the gloom to the scenes of the morning so soon to dawn. In faith and hope, we may confidently say, "The morning cometh, when there will be no more night. Soon we shall see the dawn of the eternal day in all its glorious beauty and splendor." End quote. Letter 136, 1902. Manuscript Release, Volume 16, page 349. Quote, "Our present trying, waiting, watching state is represented by a dark night, and the coming glory before us by the morning. There are two parts to the morning. First, the dawn of day, and second, full daylight, which is completed by the rising of the sun. So in the glad morning before us, the day of rest will dawn at the voice of God, when His light and glory rests upon us. Then we shall rise from glory to glory till Christ appears, to clothe us with immortality and give us life. O glory, hallelujah! My poor heart is set on fire for the kingdom. While I dwell on this sweet prospect before the true believer, if we hold fast but a few days more, the dark shades of night will vanish before the glory of the preparatory scenes of the coming of the Son of Man." End quote. Word to the little flock, James White. Page 8. Quote, "Soon we heard the voice of God, like many waters, which gave us the day and hour of Jesus' coming." End quote. Early Writings, page 14. Introduction. In Leviticus 16, we find that the ceremonies and sacrificial offerings on the Day of Atonement are divided into two parts before the high priest leaves the Most Holy to transfer the sins from the sanctuary to the scapegoat. The first part is for the high priest and his house, and involves a bullock, verses 3, 6, and 11 to 14. And the second one is for the rest of the people, and involves a goat, verses 5, 7 to 10, 15, and 16. The first one is for the ministry, the second one is for the rest of the congregation, as it is written. Quote, "And Aaron shall bring the bullock of the sin offering, which is for himself, and shall make an atonement for himself and for his house, and shall kill the bullock of the sin offering, which is for himself, and he shall take a censer full of burning coals of fire from off the altar before the Lord, and his hands full of sweet incense, beaten small, and bring it within the veil. And he shall put the incense upon the fire before the Lord, that the cloud of the incense may cover the mercy seat, which is upon the testimony, that he die not. And he shall take the blood of the bullock, and sprinkle it with his finger upon the mercy seat eastward, and before the mercy seat shall he sprinkle of blood with his finger seven times. Then shall he kill the goat of the sin offering, that is for the people, and bring his blood within the veil, and do with that blood as he did with the blood of the bullock, and sprinkle it upon the mercy seat and before the mercy seat." End quote. Leviticus chapter 16, verses 11 through 15. From these verses we learn that the priest first kills the bullock, then goes within the veil with its blood and sprinkles its blood upon the mercy seat, verses 11, 12, and 14. Then after he does that, he is to kill the goat and bring its blood within the veil, verse 15. In order to sacrifice the goat and collect its blood, the priest would have to come out of the sanctuary after he offered the blood of the bullock, as the goat was to be sacrificed outside of it in its court. The scriptures would not have twice mentioned the priest going within the veil if he was to go in only once. Furthermore, if he went in twice, he also would have come out twice. Once after he offered the blood of the bullock before the sacrifice of the goat, and a second time after offering of the blood of the goat. Actually, the high priest went in and out of the sanctuary three times, not just twice. That is, he was required to first offer incense before the mercy seat of the ark before he presented the blood offerings. Leviticus chapter 16, verses 12 and 13. As we read, quote, "And he shall take a censer full of burning coals of fire from off the altar before the Lord, and his hands full of sweet incense beaten small, and bring it within the veil. And he shall put the incense upon the fire before the Lord, that the cloud of the incense may cover the mercy seat that is upon the testimony, that he die not." End quote. There we find that the high priest took a censer full of burning coals of fire from off the bronze, brazen, KJV, altar of burnt offering that stood in the court of the sanctuary, and with a handful of incense entered into the sanctuary through the first veil, and then placed the burning coals upon the golden altar of incense that stood before the second veil, and then placed the incense upon those fresh coals. That is the first time the priest entered the sanctuary. Of course, he had to leave it after that first time in order to obtain the blood of both the bullock and the goat. Thus, the high priest was quite active on that day in repeatedly going both in and out of the sanctuary. We should, then, expect to see antitypes of all those types during the antitypical Day of Atonement, and not just the final ones, as has previously been the case. Quote, "What was done in type in the ministration of the earthly sanctuary is done in reality in the ministration of the heavenly sanctuary." End quote. Great Controversy, page 420. While Adventists have long taught of the intercession of the goat for the Lord, which represents Christ, for the congregation, and the placing of the sins which are transferred from the sanctuary to the goat, for Azazel, a symbol of Satan, we have not, as a body, taught anything of the antitypical significance of the intercession of the bullock for the high priest and his house, which comes first. Though the commentators among us freely admit in the Seventh-day Adventist Bible commentary that the priest was to twice go into the sanctuary, first with the blood of a bullock, and second with the blood of a goat, they don't give any antitypical significance to the first time the high priest was to enter the Most Holy with the blood of the bullock for himself, and none at all to the fact that said intercession was also for his house. The reason they give for the atonement being made for the high priest in the typical service is this, quote, "Before Aaron was prepared to make atonement for others, he must make an atonement for himself. Free from sin, he now became a fit representative of Christ, the sinless one, and might therefore mediate on the behalf of others." End quote. SDA Bible Commentary, page 775 and 776. While the above is certainly true as it applies to Aaron and the succeeding high priests, and they acknowledge that the same was necessary for the priests, his house, that ministered with him on that day, why wouldn't there be an antitype of all of that first part of the ceremony represented by the bullock as it involves Christ's own antitypical work as the high priest in the heavenly sanctuary for himself and his antitypical house, if there was to be one for all the latter points of it? Is there any biblical basis for disregarding a significant portion of the ceremonies of that day? As they only speak of the typical atonement for the high priest and his house, and as they have nothing to say on the antitypical fulfillment of that whole first part of the ceremony, they are not speaking according, quote, to the law and to the testimony, end quote. And thus, quote, there is no light in them, end quote. Isaiah chapter 8, verse 20, in that regards. That doesn't mean that they are wicked, but simply that they are in darkness in regards to the, quote, wondrous things of that part of thy law, end quote. Psalm 119, verse 18. And of the glorious antitypical fulfillment of those types. Quote, the Bible must not be interpreted to suit the ideas of men, however long they may have held these ideas to be true. We are not to accept the opinion of commentators as the voice of God. They were erring mortals like ourselves. God has given reasoning powers to us as well as to them. We should make the Bible its own expositor. End quote. Gospel Workers, 1892 edition, page 126. Quote, many think that they must consult commentaries on the Scriptures in order to understand the meaning of the Word of God. And we would not take the position that commentaries should not be studied. But it will take much discernment to discover the truth of God under the mass of the words of men. How little has been done by the Church as a body professing to believe the Bible to gather up the scattered jewels of God's Word into one perfect chain of truth. The jewels of truth do not lie upon the surface as many suppose. The mastermind in the confederacy of evil is ever at work to keep the truth out of sight and to bring into full view the opinions of great men. The enemy is doing all in his power to obscure heaven's light through educational processes, for he does not mean that men shall hear the voice of the Lord saying, this is the way, walk ye in it. End quote. Christian Education, 1893-1894, page 85. There can be no doubt that the Lord has had his hand somewhat over this matter, for there is nothing in the published writings of Ellen G. White that addresses the reason and purposes of these two distinct aspects of the atonement, the offering of the bullock for the priesthood and the goat for the rest of the people. Nevertheless, quote, all Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, end quote. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16. Therefore, there must be something of import in those details of the typical service, for there is nothing unprofitable, superfluous, or without a reason in the Word of God. It is written, quote, it is the glory of God to conceal a thing, but the honor of kings is to search out a matter, end quote. Proverbs chapter 25, verse 2. As the antitypical sanctuary work of our high priest is the unique feature of Adventist theology, we should be able, quote, to give an answer to every man that asketh you a reason of the hope that is in you, end quote. 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 15, regarding the meaning of all the events on the typical day of atonement and their antitypical fulfillment. Therefore, let us approach the throne of grace in all humility, seeking to better understand the antitype of the intercession for the high priest and his house. Some have concluded that since the high priest represented Christ, there wouldn't be a need for an atonement to be made for him, as he was sinless. But since he was made sin for us when he bore our sins, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 20, he likewise needed an atonement for himself, not for his personal sins, for he had none, but to cleanse him of the sins he bore in our stead. Remember, God, quote, made him to be sin for us, end quote. even so much so that the Father had to turn his face from him when he was on the cross because of his disgust for sin. Quote, "The captain of our salvation was perfected through suffering. His soul was made an offering for sin. It was necessary for the awful darkness to gather about his soul because of the withdrawal of the Father's love and favor. For he was standing in the sinner's place, and this darkness every sinner must experience. The righteous one must suffer the condemnation and wrath of God, not in vindictiveness, for the heart of God yearned with greatest sorrow when his Son, the guiltless, was suffering the penalty of sin. This sundering of the divine powers will never again occur throughout the eternal ages." End quote. Manuscript 93, 1899, SDA Bible Commentary, Volume 7, page 924. To stand in the sinner's place, Christ had to not only bear the penalties of the sinner's sin, but the very sins themselves. His death would have been fruitless had he not been bearing the actual sins that had been transferred from sinners to himself. The atonement done for him, though, was not made by means of a sinless substitute, as it has been done for us through his sacrifice, but his own atonement was made by his offering the blood of his own sinless life. Quote, "By his own blood he entered in once into the holy place." End quote. Hebrews chapter 9, verse 12. When he entered in at that time, he did so as high priest. But to understand the nature of the sacrifice for Christ as high priest, we must look to why there was both a bullock and a goat sacrificed in the services of that day. As all the typical sacrifices pointed to Christ's sacrifice, the different types of sacrifices must point to different aspects of Christ's sacrifice. What, then, is the difference between Christ's sacrifice as a bullock for the priest and his house on the Day of Atonement, and Christ's sacrifice as a goat? The Hebrew is literally a kid of a she-goat for the rest of the congregation on that day. The key to this mystery is found in the fact that, quote, "God was in Christ, reconciling the world to himself," end quote. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 19. By definition, a bullock is a father of cattle, while a goat is a son, kid, of a she-goat. It was truly a sacrifice for the Father to send his Son to suffer and die. When he had to turn away his face from his Son while he was on the cross, that was a sacrifice, painful beyond words. Quote, "The heart of God yearned with greatest sorrow," end quote. In commenting on that verse of 2 Corinthians, Ellen White says, quote, "It wasn't only Jesus who suffered for the sins of the world. The Godhead was stirred with pity for the race, and the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit gave themselves to the working out of the plan of redemption." End quote. Councils on Health, page 222. Quote, "God was in Christ in human form and endured all the temptations wherewith man was beset. In our behalf he participated in the sufferings and trials of sorrowful human nature." End quote. The Southern Work, December 10, 1907. SDA Bible Commentary, page 930. Quote, "It was then seen that God had in his Son denied himself, giving himself for the sins of the world, because he loved mankind. The Creator was revealed in the Son of the infinite God. Hear the question, can there be self-denial with God? Was forever answered." End quote. Manuscript 50, 1900, SDA Bible Commentary, page 974. With these thoughts in mind, we can see that the sacrifice of the bullock, a father of cattle, represents the Father's sacrifice, his intercession for us, in and through his Son, while the sacrifice of the goat represents Christ's own sacrifice and intercession. That is, the Father was not obligated to forgive any sin, except by his very nature, even the sins that Christ bore. The Father, the heavenly bullock, had to sacrifice himself in forgiving the sins Christ bore. Had he not, Christ would not have been resurrected and made the high priest of our salvation, for he did not fully bear those sins, even unto the second death. Christ didn't render the judgment on whether or not his sacrifice was accepted. The Father did, and that was a sacrifice on his part. See John chapter 20, verse 7, and The Desire of Ages, page 790 and page 833 through 835. Thus, the sacrifice of the bullock for the high priest and his house shows that God, the Father, for his holy name's sake, is, in and through Christ, to make an atonement for the high priest, Christ, on the antitypical Day of Atonement for the sins that he bore in becoming sin for us, and also for his house, before Christ, the Son, as the goat of God, does so for the rest of the congregation. It is written, quote, "So Christ was once offered to bear the sins of many, and unto them that look for him shall he appear the second time without sin unto salvation." End quote. Hebrews chapter 9, verse 28. On the cross, Christ appeared with sin upon him. But when he returns, he will appear without sin. The sins he bore must be removed from him by his Father's own intercession, who was, quote, "in him reconciling the world unto himself," end quote. In the type, it was not merely the shedding of the blood and the death of the innocent victim that atoned for the sin, because the atonement was actually accomplished by what was done with the life of the substitute after it was brought into the sanctuary by means of its blood. Yet, regardless of whether or not Christ, as high priest, may need to have an atonement made for himself, the fact still remains that the first act of intercession with the bullock on the typical Day of Atonement is said to be not only for the high priest, but also for his house. Where there is a type, there is also an antitype.